Welcome to The Writer's Dream. This is a show where authors can talk about how they write their books, how they publish their books, and how they market their books. You can find us on Facebook, just look for The Writer's Dream, as well as YouTube. Same thing, look for The Writer's Dream. If you have a question for us, please message us through Facebook. Today's guest is Joe Giannini. He is a fellow producer here at LTV, and he has a show called Gung Ho. Welcome, Joe.
Thank you.
Tell us about yourself.
Born in Brooklyn during the war. My dad was in the Army at the time. My mom was working for the federal government. I was raised in Nassau County, graduated Massapequa High School. I was a wrestler, played football, went to Hofstra University, and right from there, I enlisted in the Marine Corps, and I wound up becoming an officer, volunteered for Vietnam, made it through that mess, came back, went to law school on a GI Bill, and right out of law school, I started working as a criminal defense lawyer, and I worked for over 40 years in criminal defense. Didn't get involved in politics until about 60 years old, and I didn't start writing until I was about 60 years old.
Yeah, I think that's a common story. I myself was not politically active until much later. I think retirement affords you the time that you need to do that, and same thing with writing. But how did you get involved with the studio here?
When Kerry was running for president, a good friend of mine, Michael Neal, a local guy, said, let's do a show, and we called it Veterans for Kerry, and we started that in 2004, and we just kept doing shows. When Kerry lost the election, we just stayed on. Ed Stateman said, let's keep going, call it East End Veterans, and we've been at it now for, I guess, 13 years or 14 years, but, you know, a lot of the people that started with me, Ed is dead, who else? Our director died, the real Lee Davis, some of the veterans are incapacitated, but I keep going.
Good for you, good for you. So, where do you get your guests now? How do you come across vets who are willing to come on the show?
I know a lot of people. Mm-hmm. I've met vets when I was very politically active, traveling all over. I met a lot of vets. I met a lot of people. So I just asked them to come on the show. The best guests have been vets that are just back from the wars.
Sure.
And they tell us their experiences about going in, being there, and coming home. And that's the most powerful things. I've had authors, politicians, people from the VA, all kinds of guests.
Well, I think that's the great thing about a local access TV show is that you can talk about your political views without worrying about your sponsor not
right.
liking your political views. So what topics have you been discussing lately that are issues for vets?
Well, there's a lot of talk about, excuse me, post-traumatic stress disorder.
Which you are illustrating right now.
Yes. post-traumatic stress, traumatic brain injury, what else? Exposure to toxic gases in Iraq and Afghanistan. Oh, what else? Agent Orange is still a big topic.
Let's take Agent Orange, because you're a victim of Agent Orange, as are most Vietnam vets. What are the symptoms?
Actually, what it is I didn't know all of this until I had to learn it firsthand. But Agent Orange is a toxic thing called, well, the main ingredient is dioxin. They didn't tell us anything about it when we went to Nam. There was no phrase called Agent Orange. We didn't know. We knew they were defoliating. We didn't realize how harmful it could be. It turns out it's what you call, I think what they call it, it's an ecocide. It kills everything that it comes into touch with because it goes into the ground, the water, and it goes into us, and it doesn't go away. So one manifestation is young men getting diseases that old men have and dying right away, which happened to a lot of Vietnam vets. Mm-hmm. And someone like me, in my see, in 2013, when I was like just 70 years old, all of a sudden, things started going wrong. And turns out I have chronic ischemic coronary heart disease. It's almost killed me. I've had a couple of heart attacks. I've been operated on. And the government has now admitted, finally, in 2010, they did it in writing. If you have this, it was caused by Agent Orange. I have it. It has completely...
So it's probably through political action, like of vets like yourself, that the government feels this pressure and then finally comes to admit things.
It's been political action from the get-go, from the Vietnam Veterans Against the War, even John Bean out here, famous Vietnam vet, Marine, politician. He advocated for us when it came to Agent Orange specifically. It's been a real struggle. In fact, there's legislation right now, that's so much. Now they want to push through legislation that would take care of our offspring. Our offspring, that means veterans' children.
Yeah.
And it's going to be their children, too, that are being affected by being exposed.
Yeah, see, this is, and during the first Gulf War, men were coming back with strange ailments, and the government was not admitting to the fact that they were using, that they were exposed to chemicals, whether it was from the other side or our own side, and now that's come to fruition, that they're recognizing that.
Yeah, the first Gulf War was 1990,
yeah.
So it's like what, 27 years later?
Mm-hmm, almost 30 years. Yeah.
It makes me angry.
Yes, well, so. I should make the whole country angry.
And a lot of my buddies that made it out, they're dying from being exposed to Agent Orange. They have cancer, they have heart disease. And these are all people that thought they made it out without a scratch.
Mm-hmm.
Didn't.
So what's your current issue that you are focusing on, or do you have one?
Well, I talk a lot, again, about post-traumatic stress, and I keep pointing out that the young vets that are coming home now are even worse than the Vietnam vets because they're being sent back to do multiple tours. That is horrible. Because it's going to give them PTSD, or they're going to wind up with a catastrophic wound, have to live with it for the rest of their life, or they're going to wind up addicted to drugs or committing violent crimes. You know something, though? Nobody, I can't say nobody, but Americans as a whole don't care about what's happening because they have no skin in the game.
That's only right.
That very small percentage of 1% that's fighting over and over and over. And they keep sending back people. I just read a story in the New York Times. He just got killed of 6 tour. He was 42 years old.
Yeah.
In Nam, 42.
Nobody.
The only one that was 42 was the battalion commander.
Yeah.
Nobody else was 42. That's a big issue.
It's a big issue. And also the issue of the fact that you mentioned this, these catastrophic injuries that they have. On the one hand, you can say that every war contributed to medical advances. For instance, these prosthetic limbs that they have and whatnot. But the other hand, these people who are coming back with these injuries have to be cared for. And that's another issue that we have to deal with. So there has to be an advocacy for that. Wounded Warriors Project.
I'm not involved with the Wounded Warriors, but I've been involved in other projects called Operation Beachhead, which was started by Marines, actually a Marine that was wounded in Vietnam. Mike Kurse, I think his name is. And I've been to several of his events down in New Jersey where wounded veterans come in, and we hang out for a few days, and we spend time on the beach, and we get them into the water. Mm-hmm. On surfboards.
Yeah, they do that in Long Beach, here on Long Island. They do.
Yeah.
They had a program, I guess it was last year I saw the footage on that.
Mike Ritchie, wounded Vietnam veteran. And I met more vets when I've done those events. And these young vets, some of them were paralyzed from the neck down, some of them were missing limbs, and they were like so, such great kids. I call them kids.
Well, they are
such
kids.
Such great kids. And, and there's an instant rapport between the young vets and the older vets.
Sure. Well, of course, it's a common experience.
Yeah, like brothers, all, you know, just.
Yeah. I wanted to ask you, this is something that made me very curious, is your career in criminal law, as a criminal lawyer, how did your Vietnam experience affect your dealing with criminal law?
First of all, my experience in Vietnam made me the type of person that nothing could faze me in a courtroom. So I could handle anything in the courtroom, and I did. I wasn't intimidated by cops or detectives or prosecutors or judges. They were mostly intimidated by me. But I wound up using, you know, what I learned in Vietnam about getting the mission done, doing it the right way. My first major case was a Vietnam vet, honorable discharge, and he was facing 15 to life under the Rockefeller law. He was framed by these dirty cops, anti-crime cops. And I tried the case, and I won the case. Along the way, I helped other vets, some Marines actually, too. And my last trial was my friend Jen Farber's boyfriend, a vet, a really good soldier. I mean, he would... outstanding soldier, honorable discharge. He got framed by the police. He was indicted, and he went to trial, and he was acquitted. And what I realized during that trial, which is so tragic, he was one of those vets that fell through the crack, because they looked at him. Everybody looked at him and said, wow, he's a combat vet, and he's a bad guy, and he's dangerous. And that's horrible. Mm-hmm. And they actually, this is really strange, but in the courtroom, they got frightened of me too, because they knew I was a combat vet, and I was very aggressive, and they thought I was a danger, and I wasn't. And he not. And
you were
he
just
wasn't
doing
either.
Your job.
I was just doing.
Yeah. Well, that's the other thing is the whole. I think the war experience, I certainly don't have any experience with that, but the war experience makes you different.
It does.
And I think that those of you who survive it, and I don't mean just get out, but survive the experience and continue as you have with an active life, you present a formidable image to people. You know, you're looked at with respect because you've overcome something that to anybody who thinks has to be a really incredibly dangerous and life-changing experience. Tell us about this picture, because I think picture speaks to it.
In Vietnam, if a soldier or Marine got killed, the first thing they did was wrap him in his own poncho. The next thing is he was on his way back home by chopper. And I watched it a few times, and every Marine had a rotation date. We came in on individual orders then, and I called it poncho rotation. I never said that in Vietnam. I never called it out loud poncho rotation, but that's what it was. The sad thing about it is that that's exactly what's going on right now. Soldier or Marine, man or woman gets killed, they get wrapped in their poncho and they're chopped away or they're Humveed away. Like you said when we were talking, I think it's planned, out of sight, out of mind. They don't want our dead to be around us too long. And it's very unusual to have bodies laying around, American bodies. They get them out.
Well, this is even during George Bush's presidency. He didn't want the media showing the flag-draped coffins coming back to Dover because he didn't want the American public. That to me is so planned that only 1% of the population is involved in this. The rest of us are doing whatever we're doing. And because I think if it was like Vietnam where there was a draft and everybody was involved, maybe we wouldn't be so involved in all of this constant warfare.
The wars that are going on now, when you ask Americans what they think the important issues are, in many cases the wars don't even are not on the list, or they're like 14th or 15th on the list. Mm-hmm. People just don't care. They don't know because they don't have any skin in the game. I'm talking about a son or a husband or a nephew or a grandchild. That's it. It's just that less than 1% who we are absolutely destroying because we keep recycling them into these war zones. Yeah. And I see it. I see it.
Sure. I think if you watch the right shows on television and listen to the right population, the right politicians, you see it as well. I loved Joe Biden for that because he would always talk about the veterans, his son, and don't forget them. So, yeah, this is a tough issue. But you also used writing. But let's talk about something first. Surfing. Tell us about your surfing experience and what it did for you, and then we'll get into your writing.
Surfing I started when I was a teenager, and I just loved it. Became an addiction, but a good addiction. And I joined the Marine Corps. One of the reasons I joined the Marine Corps was that I thought I could surf, and I did get to surf one time at China Beach.
For the younger viewers, where is China Beach?
Vietnam, Da Nang. And there was such a thing as a China Beach Surf Club. Mm-hmm. And then when I came home from Nam, I immediately was stationed down at Virginia Beach, and I started surfing again, you know. And I didn't realize what I was doing. I was surfing. I threw myself into my work, surfing and working out. And I didn't realize that until the preview of this movie called Between the Lines about surfers during the Vietnam War. My son stood up at the end and he was talking about me, how I was so different than all the surfers that he depicted. He said, you know, my dad loved surfing, but it was his way to heal, or, you know, as much as he could. I was stunned.
So this was a movie your son produced?
No. We went to the premiere.
Oh, okay.
Some of my friends, actually, they became friends, produced it. It's going to be aired tonight, actually, on LTV.
Really?
Yeah, yes.
Okay, what time?
8:30.
All right. And you have a surfing magazine that published an article of yours.
When I was in a writing class, started in 2002, and my instructor, Barbara Wurzberg, encouraged us to send things out, and I started sending my stories out. And every time I sent a story out, it was published. I mean, so I've got like, I don't know how, well over 20 publishing credits. One of the stories was published in the Surfers Pad, which at the time was the finest surfing magazine in the world. Mm-hmm. They published a story called Big Wave Dave. They hired an illustrator, and it's a story about war and faith and surfing. And it's become like part of our lore. This, you know, the story Big Wave Dave, he's a real character. In every way. In fact, you know, he's in Bali right now surfing, and every day.
Nice.
Something from him on FaceMail, another photo. But surfing has been a really big part of my life. It's a big part of a lot of vets' lives because we realize now that was our way, that was our self-therapy, because there was no such thing. There were no safety nets when we came home.
Yeah.
There was nothing.
Yeah. Well, the Vietnam vets were treated horribly. Yeah. I distinctly remember that. My brother was a Vietnam vet.
Oh, I didn't.
And he was so, I think he was so upset by the fact that, you know, he was career Air Force. So he was in the Air Force before Vietnam and after as well. And when he came back, the way the Vietnam vets were treated, that people would say, well, you know, what did you do in the Air Force? And he would, and this was his way of really, it was a sarcastic way of fighting back. He said, I dropped bombs and killed people. He would say that. And every time he would say that, I would like, go right through me, you know. And I knew that was his pain.
And I bet that was the end of the conversation.
That's the way he dealt with his pain. It was very, very upsetting.
Well, nobody knew I was a vet. Nobody.
No, well, no, yeah, that's no
and,
one would
and
talk
I
about
didn't
it.
Talk about it, but actually I tried this really high-profile murder case of a police officer, stories in Soft Targets, and during that trial in 1990, it came out I was a Vietnam vet, and people just realized, in fact, a lot of them, I think, were stunned, like, he's a Vietnam vet. Yeah. I was aggressive, but they didn't know I was a vet.
Yeah, but I think that the feeling towards Vietnam vets is very different today.
It is.
I think so.
It only took over 40 years.
Yeah, yeah. So I want you to read, because...
Read, yeah, all right.
I don't know which... Do you want to read from this? I think this is the one you might have marked.
This is a story, Men Don't Cry. It's a lot about my dad. My dad was a he was a veteran, Army veteran, been in the Army twice. He was very patriotic, my country right or wrong, but he was really intelligent and strong, an undefeated amateur boxer. And he was always teaching me, you know, telling me things and actually teaching me how to box and things. And I'll just start with I was listening to an NPR show, and they were talking about crying, and that crying in public is not cool unless it's from grief, but they didn't mention anything about war. So I start this is one paragraph. Vic, my dad, taught me not to cry in public. He was a tough guy, grew up on the rough streets of Crown Heights, Brooklyn, built like a fire plug. Large square shoulders, strong arms, big hands, powerful legs. He loved to fight and to box, was an undefeated welterweight champ in the Army. His toughest fight in the ring was against a very fast black boxer. The guy kept moving and avoiding punches, then countering and scoring effectively. Vic saw that when he threw his right, the guy usually moved left. Vic threw two left jabs, feinting a right, then shot it where he thought the guy would move. He did. The punch landed, broke his jaw. Blood spilled from his mouth and left ear. My dad was, like I said, if he hit you, he was so powerful that if he hit you with one punch, it was over. And
there's an expression, I'll hit you so hard your mother will fall down.
He was that type, and he loved to fight. So he was teaching me to be a man and teaching me to be a tough guy. But he, you know, he was in the fight business and he dragged me around. I loved to go with him to gyms and to fights and things. So I was in his mold. I was trying to be like him. Mm-hmm. And I went in the Marine Corps. And one night on a really bad place called Alpha 3 near the DMZ. We took some incoming, actually, during the day. Mm-hmm. And this is the last paragraph. I run over the Bravo 1's position. Some of their bunkers have taken direct hits. There are many casualties, including the platoon leader, Lieutenant Grosshands. Bravo 1 was my first command. I had the platoon for 5 months. I was getting too close to them, and they were taken away from me. They start calling out to me, how bad is it, Lieutenant? Meaning, how bad are they hurt? They all have multiple shrapnel wounds. I assure each one, you're okay, and you're out of here. Each Marine is laid in his own poncho and carried away. The sun disappears behind low crowds. Cold, wind-driven rain sweep over the hill. I don't hide my tears. Out here, men cry. And that's, you know, I cried a few times in Vietnam, not out of fear or panic, it was grief, mm-hmm. and things that we were going through. And it was okay, nobody thought anything.
Yeah, you told me about letters that you wrote home.
Yeah.
And your son discovered the letters and?
What happened is in 2002, My wife, I call her my non-wife, and my mom, by coincidence, sent me all my letters. And it turns out there's hundreds and hundreds of letters that I wrote to them and my dad, my sister, and I started reading them, and something happened to me. I just wasn't here anymore. So my wife said, you know, get some help and write. So I did both. I got help in 2002. I was diagnosed with post-traumatic stress disorder. I got upset, and I stopped going for help. But I continued. I wrote, and I had a very gifted instructor, Barbara Wurzburg, and she said some things to us that just liberated me. No rules, write whatever you want. And the first thing that I wrote for the class was called Double Time Duffy, about a very tragic death of someone that I loved in Vietnam. Actually, before he went to Nam, he was my company commander in OCS. And I wrote about him, and it was published. And
since then, you've been published?
I've been.
So these letters are, this is the food for the next book?
Well, I actually, on two stories, I've actually incorporated
some of the letters.
Like one story has the whole letter, and another story just has a portion of what I was writing to my dad. The letters are important.
So I want to see that become a book before I'm in this game 6 years, right? So one last thing. You got 41 seconds. Piece of advice to a writer, piece of advice to a vet?
Right. It's really, it's the best thing you could do for yourself and for other people, because if you write it and they read it, that's really important.
Yeah, one of the things I like to say is civilizations are defined by their stories.
Stories are the most important thing.
People have to tell those stories,
because the writing comes from the stories.
Right.
And it's the most important thing to me right now, is to write and get it out there. So I'm going to keep writing.
Thank you for your service.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you for what you've been doing, because I think it's very important work.
Thank you.
And that's our show.
Okay.